That when we need God to make a way, He makes a way. That He's still in the miracle working business, and He's not just a promise maker. God is a promise keeper. You believe that today, church? Amen. Amen. Y'all can have a seat. You are way too out of control today. Sit down.
Hey, so this is awesome. I just want to, like, I can't see a thing other than this bright light, but I'm pretty sure there's a lot of you out here. Man, worship just feels so cool whenever all of us lift our voices together. It's just something awesome. But I say that because, like, this sometimes, like, I saw some people that, like, I want to say hi to. I may not get a chance to do that because it's so, like, crowded in here. So we've got some opportunities coming up that would be great if you guys came so that you could, like, have conversation with people that you go to church with. There's a lot of them maybe that you don't even know. So October the 27th, a couple weeks from now, from 4 to 6 p.m., we're going to be just down here down the road. We have one of these flyers in the lobby for Fall Fest. So what's cool about Fall Fest, and again, all you got to bring is a chair and a Chiefs jersey. So
yes, that work. Yes, do that too.
You know, if you wear a different
that's
kind.
That's your admittance,
I mean, I'm sure somebody else is having a Fall Fest. That's you it. Could probably go to theirs.
Just go to town, take one off somebody and bring it.
I should just say that. You can come too. 4 to 6 p.m., there is a game that day, so we'll have it on screen. You guys can watch it. So, again, I say that because I worry about that. I'm like,
I know.
Is that during the
Jesus? I worry about it, too.
I have a volleyball game.
Jesus
I
cares
watch.
About it.
Yes,
yeah.
I know. So, anyway, 4 to 6 p.m. But, like, I've had conversations every single year with somebody that I remember. I remember
you think back, and you're like, that's where I got to meet so-and-so, or that's where we began that relationship. And so, it's really cool to meet people outside of this place. That's a great opportunity to do that, Fall Fest.
Tracy Fisher bakes stuff. It's so good.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
It's at the Fisher's house.
Anyway, that's at their house, and that's coming up on the 27th. Put that on your calendar. We'd love it if you would you would be a part of that.
Yeah, and directions are on the back of the flyer. There's a flyer out there that looks just like the one Colin's holding here. Grab one of those. Directions on the back, how to get there.
Colin's holding a lot of things. Colin's holding one of these, too.
Yeah, there's also one of these, a river trunk or treat. We're going to do something a little different this year. We try to change things up as much as we can. We're going to do a river trunk or treat on October 31st.
Yeah,
it's on Halloween. I wondered about it. Like, sometimes you can say it, you can't say it.
It's Halloween.
If you're offended, we're sorry.
We're
not sorry. But October 31st, a trunk or treat right here in the parking lot. If you're interested in doing something like that, that would be great. We don't want you to have, you know, traps built into a haunted house or anything or nothing like that. Yeah. But we'll decorate. We'll have a little fun and pass candy out to kids, and just a great way to meet our community as well. So we'll have that. If you're interested in that, grab one of these flyers. There's a phone number on that. Miss Stephanie Chambers is heading that up. She will take your call or your text and give you that information on that trunk or treat October 31st. Don't miss it.
Yeah, and if you're not even interested, you should just text her or something. Just bother her.
That's do that too.
Yeah, for sure.
I don't care anything about the trunk or treat. Hi.
We're in a series right now called Taken. We're going to start in just a second. We get a lot of questions about passing baskets. We're not going to do that. So if you're a guest of ours, we're glad you're here. When we take an offering, we do all that. There's baskets in, or there's a box on the back that we do drop that in. We do that to support our ministries that we do here all over the place in the community. We're really lucky to have people who are real faithful in that regard. So I want to pray over that. I want to pray over our morning. I want to pray over our series. If you guys would, just as a church, let's go to Him. God, we're fortunate to be where we are, God, that we live in a place where we have not just enough, but we have plenty. We're thankful for that. We're reminded of that sometimes in different ways. We serve you, God, because of how good you are. Those words, they never get old. Miracle worker, light in the darkness. Whatever it is that in this room we heard this morning, it seems like there's always a word that stands out to me. Light in the darkness, that's the one I heard this morning, God. Whatever it is for people in this church that we heard this morning, I just pray that that you would let that blossom in our hearts today, that whatever it is that we came here to hear this morning, that we would hear it, that we would take it, and that we would let it change us. We know that none of that will happen unless God, you are in the middle of it. So just pray that you be honored in this time. We love you. We thank you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said.
Oh!
last week we began this series of thought called Taken. And we had a guy walk into the room in chains with a bag over his head. That was cool. Got a lot of comments about that. Hey, just so you know, I've got this thing in my throat that's killing me. Colin's so awesome about bringing me water. I'm going to drink some stuff. I've got some stuff in my mouth. You're going to have to get over it because it's what I got going on. Just kind of calling it. Excuse me. Last week, if you weren't here, then you can go to our YouTube channel, type in River Church Forsyth, watch it, catch back up to where we are today. Today, the thought, though, we will be in the book of Philippians chapter 3. If you brought your Bibles, you can turn there, but I'm going to get there in a bit, but I want to kind of set this up this morning. I want to start with a question today. You're in church. You got to be honest. Have you ever, in your life, have you ever been at a place in life where you felt like you weren't good enough? Most of us, I think, have felt that way at some point in our lives, except for the narcissist. We're glad you're here. It's another sermon for another day. But I would say that most of us have wrestled with that thought. Am I good enough? Am I strong enough? Am I godly enough, right? And then for those of us that somehow get beyond that place, right, where we make it to a place where maybe we feel like we are good enough, and then isn't it just like God's timing where somebody else comes along in that moment, and they're way better at what you're doing than you are, you know that place too, right? Like where you're at a gym, and you're working out, and you're working towards a goal. They call it a PR, personal record, right? Maybe you go to the bench press and you put on that certain amount of weight and you're like, I'm doing this today. I'm going to put that up one time. And you try it and you do it. And so now you're all giddy, right? You're kind of celebrating and you're looking back at the weight and you're like, wow, I did that. And then somebody walks up and says, hey, are you using this bench? And you're like, you say no, but you really want to say, hey, I just put that up one time. And then they lay down and they do it 15 times for a warm-up, right? And that's when you're like, that's it, I quit. I'm not doing this anymore. Or maybe this happened to me. You go to a music store, you're contemplating buying a guitar, and you look at the guitar, and a guitar is like a girlfriend. You know, you're like, just meant to be. And you're looking at that guitar, and you're like contemplating the purchase of that guitar. And then a 10-year-old walks up, right, grabs the guitar and starts crushing the Hotel California solo. And you're like, are you kidding me right now? I don't even know why I'm here. I remember in high school, my sophomore year of high school, my counselor called me into her office. She told me I needed to take a special reading class because I was behind on my reading. And so I walk into the class on the very first day, and the teacher was a former kindergarten teacher. I recognized her. And the problem was, she still talked to us like high schoolers, like we were in kindergarten. And the whole reason that I was there in that class was because I wasn't learning and reading as fast as my other class members. And I struggled with that. I struggled to feel good enough and smart enough, right? And maybe you can relate to that, a place of not quite feeling good enough. But maybe for you, your social media is full of families with the perfect family picture, right? But your family, every time you get them together and you try to take a picture, you can't get half of them to smile. And so, but you post a picture anyway, and you try to pretend that it's okay. And then in all of that baggage that we kind of carry around in life, then we go to church and we walk into a place like this and we walk in like everything is okay when it's really not. I don't know, maybe you're not in that place today, but I would say that we've all wrestled with that feeling of not being good enough. I have all my life. And all my life I went to church and I showed up to a place like this where I learned that Jesus loves us, right? Where that Jesus saves us and that he loves you and he died for you, but hey, you better not mess that up. Right? Yes, Jesus made it right, but don't go and wrong everything up again. Don't go breaking everything that Jesus already fixed by making mistakes or bringing your shortcomings. And then for us, for those of us that have went through that, you know, then church for us becomes this place where, yes, Jesus saves you, but you're just not sure that he's enough to sustain you. And if something is somehow wrong in your life, then the saving that Jesus did may or may not take, right? And for some of us, maybe not all of us, but for some of us, this is the Christianity that we kind of buy into. This is the Christianity that we're shown, the Christian lie that if you want more, you have to do more. Anybody ever buy into that lie? That if you want more from God, then you have to do more for God. And then we become a Christian that somebody walks up to you and they say, hey, you got to read your Bible. And you're like, okay, cool. You mean like 10 to 15 minutes a day or something? And they're like, no, like 10 to 15 chapters a day. And that's great until you land in the book of Leviticus where they're killing goats and all the animals and the rituals. And you're like, what is happening? I don't understand this. Or you land in the book of Job and you find yourself reading Job and you're so depressed that you got to seek counseling. We're actually doing a series on Job for real very soon. It'll be fun. But when you're a new Christian and somebody guilts you into your new reading assignment, right? You don't feel like it's fun at all. And you're like, well, and that person says, well, being a Christian is not supposed to be fun. It's supposed to be work. It's a job. And you're like, well, I already have one of those. But you pull out your Bible and you read it and you try reading it. And your friend says, you know what? You just need to plow through it. And so you plow through it, and then they're like, hey, how's your prayer life? And you're like, you know, it's pretty good. I pray 3 times a day, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And they're like, no, that's not prayer. That's not it at all. Listen, when it comes to prayer, and this is just me, your pastor, talking, but when it comes to prayer, I've never felt like I pray well, especially in front of people. Anybody with me? Like, listen, I pray all day. All day I talk to God. But I'm talking about praying in front of people. When it comes to praying in front of people, I kind of feel inadequate, like I'm not very good at it. But you know what? When you're a pastor and you go to family functions and you go to reunions, guess who gets called every time to pray the blessing before the food? This guy. You ever been to those places where maybe the guy stands up and he prays in front of people? And the guy, like, he's just supposed to give the blessing, but he's casting out demons. And you're like, wow, I just want to eat, right? Or the guy that stands up and he's supposed to pray and he starts yelling at God. And you're like, I don't think God has a hearing problem. Or worse, you ever been to a place where the guy starts praying and you feel awkward? And you, or a lady's praying and you feel awkward, like you shouldn't be there because they're literally having their quiet time in front of you. And public and everything, and they're praying for everything. Listen, I don't do that. Matter of fact, sometimes when I get asked to pray the blessing over food, they're like, hey, Pastor Paul, can you pray the blessing over food? I'm like, sure. Okay, everybody bow your heads. And I'll say, dear God, bless this food. Amen. And it shocks everybody. Like, they're all judging me now, you know. I meant the prayer. I meant every word of it. God bless this food. I want this food to be blessed before I eat it. I meant it from my heart. Let me tell you, there's oftentimes I don't feel good enough when it comes to prayer. And then I remember when I first became a Christian, you know, they talked to me about my Bible. They talked to me about prayer. And then somebody introduced me to journaling. And they're like, hey, you got to journal. It'll change your life. And I'm like, well, how do I journal? And they're like, you write your most inner thoughts down in that journal. And I'm like, all of them? I'm like, what? You mean the real ones? My real thoughts? And they're like, yep. And I'm like, what if I die and somebody reads that stuff? And I'll never forget, the person was like, that's just the cost of being a Christian. And I'm like, I don't know about that. And maybe you're here today and you got all that too when you became a Christian. See, we sign up to follow Jesus but maybe you never felt like you were good enough to follow Jesus. Which, by the way, let me just share a few things as we get started here today. When you and I are doing what we feel that we should do as Christians, we're praying, we're reading our Bibles, we're giving, we're serving, but then maybe you go through a time of anxiety in your walk with Jesus, right? And there's this moment of feeling overwhelmed, and maybe you go to your spiritual advisor with this, and they give you some advice and some guidance, and their advice to you is this: you got to do more, you got to try harder. And we try it, only it doesn't work. Well, you know what begins to happen for us as followers of Jesus? We begin to take on more chains. You ever realize that? You ever realize how easy it becomes to take on more chains, even when you're following Jesus? It happens to Christians all the time. We take on chains like the chain of judgment. The chain of judgment. Let's be honest in here today, because we're in church. We can all be a little judgmental, can't we? Here, I don't believe you because nobody said anything. So let's test it. Let's test how judgmental we are. Let me ask you this question. Who in your life that you can think of is the most messed up person you know? If you didn't answer yourself, guess what? You're judgmental. You're welcome. Glad you're here. See, when a news story breaks, even in a small community, when a news story breaks and our ears are out perked up, you know, and we're like, hey, did you hear what so-and-so did? The only reason that we like to point out somebody else's junk is to make sure that ours isn't pointed out. You ever think about this? What if your junk made the news? How would you feel about that? I'll tell you how you'd feel about it. You'd pack your bags, you'd be out of town. That's how you'd feel about it if your junk made the news. See, if we're not careful, as followers of Jesus, as Christians, we can take on the chains of judgment. And we'll look at other people and be like, well, you don't read your Bible enough. You don't read your Bible as much as I do. You don't pray like I do. You don't worship like I do. You don't give like I do. You don't serve like I do. And then we get caught up in it. And we're captured by spiritual activity, but lacking relational intimacy with Jesus. That becomes the chains of judgment for us. I think as Christians, as followers of Jesus, we can also take on something else. We can take on the chains of anger. We get mad as Christians. Let's be honest with ourselves. Here we go. Let's go. We're already here. Let's do this. Sometimes, as a Christian, you can get mad at non-Christians because they're doing things that you secretly wish you could do. And you look at them and you're like, well, I wish I could do that, but I can't because I'm a Christian. It looks fun, but I'm over here in the middle of Job, not even knowing what I do. I'm all depressed. I got to read my 15 chapters today while you're out at the clubs boot scooting and boogieing. I don't know. I just made that up, but... We get mad. We get angry. You ever been mad at someone? You ever been mad at someone because they got blessed when you feel you should have gotten blessed? You ever look at somebody and go, God, why them? Why did you bless them, God? They're plastering their club life all over Facebook, yet you bless them. God, it's them that's getting married. It's that person that's getting the promotion. God, why are they getting a new home? I've waited a long time for a new home. Why are they getting engaged? I'm over here waiting on the right one, God, for you to bring me the one. Why them? Why them? God, I'm just over here doing what I'm called to do, and you're blessing them. And it's not fair. And when we do that, we take on the chains of anger. The third thing that I think that we take on, we take on the chains of insecurity. It's what we're talking about today. We don't feel like we're good enough. And so because of insecurity, depression begins to set in on us. Worry happens. Anxiety hovers over us. Why? Because you feel like you haven't done enough to get to God. You got to do more. And then if you can do more, then maybe, just maybe, things will change in your life. But let me be clear, when we take on chains like these, the chains of judgment, the chains of anger, the chains of insecurity, you know what happens? just turns into more chains and more chains and more chains. So allow me to give you an alternative thought to these. Write this down today. My faith is not determined by me holding on to Jesus. My faith is secured because Jesus is holding on to me. Y'all, this will change the game. Thank God. Thank God Jesus is holding on to me. See, then we can say, so why am I working so hard to do more, to get more? Why am I doing this? Thank God Jesus is holding on to me. We sang about it today. Even when we feel, right? Even when we feel that we somehow have let go of God, Jesus never lets go of us. Let's not forget, we're talking about the disciples. The disciples. All the disciples left when Jesus was arrested. They all walked away. They all walked away in fear. They all walked away in doubt. But Jesus, when he rose from the dead, they were the first people that he sought out. They were the first people that he went to find. The people who abandoned him. The people who left him in fear. That's because their faith was not determined by them holding on to Jesus. Their faith was determined by Jesus holding on to them. He never let go of them. He never gave up on them. Even when they gave up on him. Even when they turned their backs on Jesus, Jesus never turned his back on the people he loved. And he never will. Even when I look back on my own life, he's always been there. He was more present in my life than I gave him credit for. It was me who wasn't aware that I could see him. God has a plan for your life. He had a plan for your life before you were even born. And when you and I believe in him, and you and I follow him, Jesus never lets go, period. Let me give you another alternative thought to the chains that we somehow and some days choose. Here's a thought. There is power in the name of Jesus to save, sustain, and break every chain. There's power in the name of Jesus to save us, to sustain us, and break every chain that bounds us. When it comes to our faith, it's not about the work that we do. It's about the work that Jesus does for us. For me, my reluctance to walk in victory, my inability to walk in an abundant life that God promised me, is because I was trying to do things in the name of Paul. That was my problem. I was trying to make much of me. But it was never meant to be done in my name. It was always meant to be done in the name of Jesus. I needed to make much of Jesus because it was Jesus who saved me. It was Jesus who sustains me. And it's Jesus who will break every chain that binds me. That's who Jesus is. And that's what Jesus does. And we can become so consumed in our own work that we can't see his work. But there's power in the name of Jesus. So let's get into scripture today. I'm sorry that it's taken so long, but I kind of wanted to set all of that up. The book of Philippians is where we're going to be. Like I said, the Apostle Paul went to a place called Philippi, and he preached Jesus to those people, and the people responded to Jesus. But then another group of people came into town, and they started preaching Jesus and. They started saying things like, yes, accept Jesus, but there's also something else. And here's what Paul says in the book of Philippians chapter 3, starting in verse 2. Paul says, watch out for those dogs. So Paul wastes no time, does he? This is bold language. Watch out for those dogs. I think that you would agree that our society today is getting soft. There's a lot of sensitivity. Everybody's sensitive about everything. But Paul is not afraid to call a spade, or in this case, call a dog, right? He says in verse 2, watch out for those dogs, those people who do evil. So first Paul calls them dogs, and now he's calling them evil. And when we read what Paul writes here, that he's calling these people evil, we think, oh, evil people, right? You mean the people who are doing drugs and stealing things, those evil people? You mean the serial killers, those evil people, the sex traffickers, the bank robbers, But Paul is not talking about any of those people. Paul was talking about people who were in church who were doing evil. Now that's messed up. Do you know that there are people in church that do evil? I heard a guy one time, he said, man, I'd rather be in a gang fight than a church fight any day. Because at least when you're in a gang fight, you can spot the other side before they stab you in the back. In a church fight, you don't know who's going to stab you in the back. And I'm like, ouch. Paul's talking about people in church doing evil things. Verse 2, those mutilators who say you must be circumcised to be saved. Now, women, you can just kind of roll on past that, right? But for us men, this definitely gets our attention. Anybody uncomfortable already? Now that we've included the word circumcision in today's service. Hey, listen, we want to take some pressure off of you parents. We don't want you to have to feel questions from your kids over lunch today about what circumcision is. So if your kids have questions, just email us at colin@theriver.com. And he'll take care of that for you. Any question you have, he's got the answer. Pressure's off. Let's move on very quickly. So Paul tells us that these people show up at church and they start preaching salvation and circumcision. And you can bet at this point that their church attendance numbers are probably slowly starting to fall off, right? They're probably like, not sure why people aren't coming to church. I can't figure it out. We're just talking about circumcision. But all the dudes were like, honey, you go ahead and go to church, take the kids. I'm going to watch online. I think I'm going to stay home because I'm not really interested in the whole surgery thing at my age. But that's what these people were preaching, salvation and circumcision. Paul goes on to tell us about these people and their so-called agenda in verse 3. He says, for we who worship by the Spirit of God are the ones who are truly circumcised. We rely on what Christ Jesus has done for us. We put no confidence in human effort. Paul is saying, we're relying on the work of Jesus. That's what we're relying on. Not our own work. All the stuff that we do, our confidence is not in that. And then Paul begins to kind of unpack all of this. Check this out in verse 4. Though I could have confidence in my own effort, if anyone could, indeed if others have reason for confidence in their own efforts, I have even more. Listen, if anybody could brag about following Jesus, Paul could have bragged. He could have whipped out his spiritual resume if he wanted to. And then he goes into it. Verse 5, he says, I was circumcised when I was 8 days old. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful that there are some memories that we will never remember. Thank you, Jesus. Men, amen? Awesome. Okay. Paul says, verse 5, I am a pure-blooded citizen of Israel and a member of the tribe of Benjamin. So obviously Paul did the whole ancestry DNA thing, whatever. A real Hebrew, if there ever was one. I was a member of the Pharisees who demand the strictest obedience to the Jewish law. I was so zealous that I harshly persecuted the church. And as for righteousness, I obeyed the law without fault. Now, most of us in this room, we've probably had at least one day, one good day, at least one good day walking with Jesus, right? At some point in our lives, maybe there was a day where you had some really good quiet time, right? And you read something in your Bible and it really hit you. And then as the day happened, it just so happened that something was confirmed that day and you're like, wow, that quiet time was amazing and God showed me this and that's great. Or maybe you had a really great small group meeting and you were all pumped up as you were driving home. And you got, that was great. Or maybe we had a breakthrough on a Sunday morning and it's never happened like that. We probably all at least had one of those good days. But then we've all probably had some not so good days with Jesus, right? We've had some other days, you know, we've had days where our walk was amazing, but our walk with Jesus, but we've had other days where we felt like we were walked on, right? So since we like to compare ourselves, I just want to point this out. On our best day following Jesus, the Apostle Paul would put us to shame. We can't even compare ourselves to the life of the Apostle Paul. See, the Bible says that Paul knew the law. He knew the Old Testament word for word. He memorized it, and the Bible says that he obeyed the Old Testament without fault. You and I, we can't even drive somewhere without, you know, driving over the speed limit. But Paul is doing it right. And then he says this in verse 7. I once thought these things were valuable, but now I consider them worthless because of what Christ has done. See, Paul was involved in spiritual activity, but at the time he lacked relational intimacy with Jesus. And so Paul is saying, hey, I was doing all the right things, but I missed the point. The point was Jesus. I thought that I got it all right, but I got it all wrong. I thought that this was valuable, but it turns out that it's worthless. When I was a kid, I like a lot of kids, I was into trading cards. Anybody into trading cards as kids? Any guys, girls, whatever? Yeah, one, thanks for helping me out. I remember one time when I was like 12 years old, I went to a card show, and a card show was these vendors and these guys that would bring all of their cards and try to sell them, and there was like these booths and these display cases, and sometimes they would bring, you know, retired players, Hall of Fame players to sign your cards, and it was just an awesome experience for a 12-year-old. And so I remember I went to this card show, and all I had was $10, and I mowed a lawn to get that $10. And there was this one card at the time that was hot. Everybody was after it. This player was going to be a future Hall of Famer. This was his rookie card, and everybody wanted that card. All the booths wanted the card, all the kids wanted the card. If a booth had the card, they wanted like $100 for it. And so I knew that there was no way. We were talking about the card when we showed up. Everybody wanted it. But I thought, there is no way that I'll ever get one of those cards because I've just got 10 bucks. But I came to this one booth, and this guy had packs of those cards that you could open, sealed packages, and in each pack, you had the possibility of landing one of those cards. But the possibility that anyone would actually get one was super rare. And so I looked at this sign, I saw that he had the packs, and I said, how much are the packs? And he said, $10. And I was like, well, that's all I got. So, crossing my fingers, I hand him my $10 bill for one chance. And he gives me a pack of cards, and I felt like I was the blonde kid in Willy Wonka. You know? You're like looking for the gold ticket. And I'm like, wow, if only I could, you know, this $10, if I could get this card. So I hand him my money. He hands me a sealed pack of cards, and I couldn't wait to open it. And so as I opened it, he was like standing over me, watching me. And as I sorted through the cards and he's standing over me, just in case I found one in that pack, I'm like, there's no way I'm going to find one in that pack. And I couldn't believe what was happening right before my eyes. All of a sudden, I noticed the card. Yeah, the one that everybody wanted in that whole place, and I had one in the pack I just opened. Like, what are the chances? And instantly, the man who sold it to me swoops in, and he's like, hey, I tell you what, I'll trade you out of that card. And I was like, man, I just got this card. Are you kidding me? I'm not going to trade you. And he's like, hey, here's the thing. I'm going to give you an inside scoop, kid. There's this new thing called hockey cards. They're going to be huge. And I will trade you a whole box of packages of hockey cards for that one card. You just got one card. What if that guy turns out to be a dud? But this will send your kids through college. And those were some goals for a 12-year-old kid. I'm not going to lie. I was like, college. I would like to go to college. That would be cool. And the deal sounded so good that I did it. Hey, you're not making me feel any better here. You're like, oh, you're awful. You're feeling not good enough? Well, now you're really not feeling good enough. Let's pray and go home. So I walked out of that place feeling like I had made the best deal ever. Just to let you know, you're exactly right. Today I looked up what those hockey cards are worth. The whole box of cards is worth 15 whopping dollars. I thought that it would be so valuable, but it wasn't. By the way, I checked on eBay. The other card that was worth so much that day, he did become a Hall of Famer. That card is worth $9,000. And as a 12-year-old kid, that was my wife back there. She's like, you know what we could have done with $9,000? I'm so sorry. Here's the thing, and here's why I share that story. I thought that I owned something so valuable, but it ended up being completely worthless. You know what the Apostle Paul says about religion? A religion that is absent of the connection with Jesus? He called it worthless. I didn't say that. The Apostle Paul said that. Matter of fact, he was so passionate about this subject that he cussed. Did you know that? I'm going to show it to you. Some of you are like, that's not in the Bible. It's in the Bible. And I'm going to show it to you. I'm not sure you're ready for this, but here it goes. Are you ready? Verse 8. Philippians chapter 3, verse 8. Yes, everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. Paul says everything else is worthless unless you know Jesus. A connection with Jesus is what it's about. It's not a collection of works. It's a connection with Jesus. There's a big difference. And then in verse 8, he says, for his sake, I have discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage. That word garbage in the Greek is a word named skubula. Everybody say it today. Say skubula. Awesome. If you're here today and you went your whole life without cussing, sorry to end your streak, but you just did. You just did. Because that word scubula, and you cussed in church too. It's bad. That word scubula is a cuss word in our language. I'll tell you what it is. I'm not going to say the word, but it starts with an S and it rhymes with hit, lit, and quit. Okay? You with me? Paul said, when I compare my work with the work of Jesus, my work is scubula. It's worthless. Paul goes on in verse 8. He says, counting it all as garbage so that I could gain Christ and become one with him. I no longer count on my own righteousness through obeying the law. Listen, if anybody could count their own righteousness, Paul could do it. If anybody could say, hey, I've been obeying God, Paul could do it. It was Paul, but he didn't do that. He said, I'm putting that aside. Verse 9, rather I become righteous through faith in Christ. For God's way of making us right with himself depends on faith. I want to know Christ. Paul said, I had it all. I did it all. But I want to know Christ. Verse 10, I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. What's that mean? It means that if you're a Christian, not just saying you're a Christian, but you're an actual Christian following Jesus, did you know that the same spirit that lives inside of you is the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead? How crazy is that? The same spirit, that same power that can raise Jesus from the dead lives inside of you and I when we follow Jesus and have his Holy Spirit inside of us. Paul goes on in verse 10, he says, I want to suffer with him, sharing in his death. Why would he say that? Sharing in his death. Here's why. Because when Jesus is with us in our suffering, he's with us through everything. If you're here today and you're in a moment of suffering or maybe you've went through some suffering and you felt like you suffered alone, know that if you're with Jesus, you never suffered alone. He was with you the whole time. Trust me, I know what it feels like to feel like you're all alone, that nobody cares and nobody's there. But hear me today, if you are in Christ, you are never, ever alone. And you don't suffer alone either. Verse 11, so that one way or another, I will experience the resurrection from the dead. Here's what Paul is saying. Let me help you today. Write this down. My faith is not about a collection of good works. My faith is about a connection with Jesus. And you and I, we know this. My faith is not about a collection of works that I bring before God. My faith is about a connection with Jesus. It has to be. We have to be connected to Jesus. And you and I, we know this. Like, unless something is connected, there's no power. One day, a while back, my golfing buddy
asked me to play golf. He said, hey, how about let's play golf tomorrow? You up for it? And I was like, yes. What time? He said, 8 a.m. Be there. So I set an alarm on my phone. I went to bed. I plugged up my phone to charge overnight. Only when I woke up the next morning, there was no alarm. And my phone was dead, and I overslept. And I looked, and I plugged in my phone, but the charger from my phone had come unplugged from the wall. So now I'm late. Listen, y'all, you can be late for a lot of things. Don't be late for golf. And I'm late. And it killed me to text him and say, I'm late, because I hate being late. My phone was not connected, and it died. My alarm was never going to work if my phone was dead. Listen, I could have set five alarms, and it didn't matter. Why? Because it was all about the connection. It was all about the power. And for some of us today, maybe you've set alarms in your life. For some of us, you've set all the religious alarms you could. But it's not about your collection of religious alarms. It's never going to work because the connection with Jesus is not there. Jesus will break every chain that holds you when we're connected with Him. Some of us in this room, we've set personal alarms. We've set alarms that are based on what you can do. You've set alarms based on what you can accomplish, what you can be in life. But listen, alarms will never work if you don't first have a connection to the power of Jesus. If you walked in here today, you're bound in chains. Whatever the chains are, Jesus Christ holds the power to remove those chains from you if you'll let Him.
Yes, He does.
There's power in the name of Jesus. Do you believe me? If you do, stand with me all over this place today. I want to pray today. As the band comes out, God, would you please forgive us for thinking that somehow we can do more and try harder, and when we do more and try harder, that we think that that's what you're asking from us. Forgive us for that. Father, forgive us that we've lacked a connection with Jesus. Forgive us when we've lost a connection with Jesus. Help us to learn that we must surrender to you, God, and stay connected to you, God, to know Christ, to know and experience His power, to know Christ and learn how that we can suffer well like Christ. Father, help us today, in this room today, that whatever chains we've taken on, can we imagine today, God, that the chains can fall off? Help those of us today who are bound, and help us believe that you can break every chain so that we can be free. Father, we love you, and we ask these things in Jesus today. It's in your name we pray. We all say, amen. Hey, can we sing this song today?